Whitman performed in the corner of the inn they occupied, cowering from the wind. He played his lute and sang with a wooden bowl on the floor in front of him. It held a few coins, half a loaf of bread, and a baked potato still steaming, which wasn't a terrible take. He looked in good cheer, at least. He returned to the little table that Reuben and Donovan held and set his bowl upon it, propping his lute beside him. Ungrateful wretches would not know good music if it made a merry home amongst their overgrown nose hairs, plucking dulcet tones to every sneeze. Why not their ear hairs? Reuben asked, shivering and burrowing into the oversized cloak. Ear hairs are too good for the likes of them, the bard answered, perusing his bowl. Ooh, a turnip. God bless and keep you, fine gentles. The door opened to admit someone, and with it came a solid wall of icy wind. Donovan adjusted his brimmed hat, courtesy of Whitman's pack, and drew his wool coat tighter around his shoulders and hips. The sword he'd kept was belted about his waist. He wasn't confident in his use of it, but hoped the sight would give others pause. How went sales, Don? Whitman asked seriously. As well as could be expected. I paid the stable for keeping our beasts while we're here, and I managed to buy another couple of days' feed, but we'll need to provision at the next town we come to. Our money should hold us a little ways longer, but not far. Should it come to starvation, gentlemen, I will serenade us into dreams of plenty so that we might die painlessly, dancing amongst images of pies and potatoes, and turnips, of course. Whitman took a healthy bite from the root vegetable, holding it out to Reuben, who rolled his eyes and remained bundled inside the large cloak. Should it come to starvation, Wit, we'd eat you first, Donovan told him, rubbing frozen hands together. Nonsense, the boy would go first. We could eat him in a few hearty meals, whereas the majority of my cuts would go to rot before you finished. It would be a very sad demise to be so thoroughly wasted. At least we can all agree that I'd be last, Donovan said, now rubbing his arms inside his coat to warm up. Old age brought experience and poor circulation. You are much too tough and stringy, good man, Whitman agreed. It would definitely be the boy. I just hope I give you a terrible case of indigestion and that you fart in front of everyone you meet, Reuben answered tartly. Whitman looked askance. How could you? After all I've done for you, I would even make it a clean and painless death and then roast you above a perfectly laid fire and seasoned with lemon and sage and pepper. You would be fantastic. Where are we going from here? Reuben asked as Whitman jokingly wiped a drool from the corner of his mouth, eyeing the boy hungrily. At the change of subject, the young bard grinned and bit into his turnip once more. He handed the potato to Reuben. It was soft and still lukewarm, so he took a healthy bite, skin and all. Donovan pulled a hand-drawn map from his inside pocket and unfolded it on the table, tracing a finger along the creased page. We'll continue along this road here until it turns, then we'll keep off the road to cut across country until we catch this stream, which will lead us down to this town here. We'll provision and then race to the base of this mountain village. They do good trading with the order and will be able to hide us. We'll send someone from there to bring a few soldiers for protection and go with them to the order. You know this area impressively well, Whitman mused. Have you come this way before? A few times, yes, but as I said, I can read a map. Donovan folded the drawing and tucked it away. Now that the little herd is gone, we'll draw less attention. Assuming we can keep ours fed and watered, Reuben added. They eat more than Whitman does, and I've never seen a man eat a whole pie before. It was raspberry, the bard exclaimed, licking his lips and remembering fondly. And that server only charged me for a slice. A skilled tongue attracts all the lovers, boy. Remember that for your future. Anyway, Donovan sighed, exasperated. We'll stay the night here. There's no reason to carry on while it's threatening a storm, and we'll leave at dawn. Whitman exclaimed, a plan! They steeled themselves against the troubles that would surely meet their path, planning and plotting their future, knowing full well that reassessment lay in their way for no strategy lasts through the first bite of battle. Now you make it sound like we're going to fail before we've even started, Reuben whined. I'm making it sound more dramatic, the bard explained patiently. This way, when we succeed and get you all trained up, I will be able to compose my epic and win fame and fortune across the lands. King Bronn will reward me with more gold than I can count, and the courtiers will throw themselves down at my feet. Oh yes, they'll be trying to get away from the shadow of your giant head then. Whitman clutched his chest. A barb! So cruel the poisoned tip, so heartbreaking to be betrayed by a friend. Avenge me, dear Donovan, with your last breath, avenge me! Whitman slid under the table. Donovan reached over and flicked Reuben's ear. The boy grabbed the smarting appendage and glared at the older man. Whitman came out from under the table at impressive speed and plopped himself down beside the boy to take a bite from his potato. Hey! Reuben snarled, wrenching his arm and meal away. You caused my death. The least you can do is give me a bite, the young man replied, unashamed. You ate your turnip. I offered you some. All right, you two, don't attract attention. I cannot help it, dear Donovan. I attract all sorts with my glib tongue, sultry voice, and excellent sense of hygiene. It is who I am.